When flying into Alice Springs, always carry a current VTC. Your VNC won't cover all the reporting points. You may be required to report via a point, so make sure that you've got a current VTC. I'd always submit a flight notification plan into the system so that they do have a heads up that you're about to come in. Alice Springs is a really busy airport. There's been times when I've arrived there and there's about 18 aircraft sort of all wanting to get in. When you're approaching Alice Springs, is make sure that you've got your landing lights on and strobes and taxi lights on, just so that they can see. Always give your estimated time of arrival because that helps them in their planning about when you're going to arrive.
The VFR routes provide a very safe means of navigation in Alice Springs if you're unfamiliar with the area. Most of the VFR routes either follow the highway, fairly prominent geographical features. VFR routes 8 and 9 provide good separation for Romeo 215 because that boundary is not always clearly defined. That's Pine Gap, previously Papa 229er.
Pine Gap is a restricted area. It's an RA3, which means that you can't plan and you won't be given an airways clearance through that. You're to avoid that area. Make sure you're familiar about where it is and stay well clear of it. If you're coming into Alice Springs from the north, there's Bond Springs, which has quite a few gliding activities, especially on weekends, so be aware that there'll be gliders in the area.
Coming in Alice, we'd expect pilots to call as far out as possible. Ideally, we'd like 50 miles. 50 miles regardless of what altitude they're at or what airspace boundary they'll enter at. And so when we get that initial call at 50 miles, normally we will tell them to report again at 30 miles. 30 miles is the first distance that we can give a visual approach to if there's no other aircraft in the way. So 30 miles is a key point for us. We may not ask you to report again until 10 or 15 miles, depending on what level you're at. So it really is dependent on traffic at the time.
No, Velma Del Lima's heavy tree gap.
The South Road VFR Route 5 is a very popular route and it's a good route for people coming up from down south. It's easy to navigate, it's the old train line.
At Alice we have no surveillance whatsoever, so we're relying on looking out the window to sight your aircraft and building a mental map and a map on the board basically of flight strips to find out where you are in respect of other aircraft so that we can separate you from other aircraft. We really rely on accurate positions, so correlating what your GPS is telling you by looking out the window and correlating that with the VTC is extremely important. All the VFR routes are designed around prominent topographical features to help you navigate. Correlating the two parts of data will cement what's happening in that aircraft as opposed to just purely relying on what you said on your GPS, because poor information in results as poor information out. It's not uncommon to just get partial calls of Alice Tower, I'm Alpha Bravo Charlie inbound via VFR Route 1. That's fine, but we need to know where you are, what level you're at, and it's more importantly, how long it's going to take you to get to Alice Springs, so an accurate estimate, because if you are a VFR pilot, you could be mixing it with a couple of 737s or Fokker 100s at the time, arriving at the same time as you, so it's very important.
Runway 30, clear to take off, make left circuit.
Runway 30, clear to take off, make left circuit, Romeo Bravo Foxtrot.
Frequency congestion can be a real issue here, so having to make three calls to get that information that we need from you, which should be given in one call, is extremely important as well. So concise, accurate information would be the key to come into Alice. To come into Alice Springs, feel free to give the tower a ring. We're more than happy to have a chat with you before you come to Alice Springs to explain what to expect, especially if you can tell us where you're coming from. We usually run through the VFR route that you'll typically follow. And if you're a competent pilot and you can fly via a VOR radial, 9 times out of 10 will clear you direct on that radial, so that'll save you a lot of time manoeuvring for the VFR route. Safaris can be a bit of a mixed bag. In a procedural environment where we have very tight tolerances and we have no other form of surveillance to be able to identify you, a good safari is one where the slower aircraft will be at the back of the pack, the faster aircraft will be at the front. So typically we get it the other way around, where everybody's converging on everybody, people are flying at similar levels and people are within a mile or two of each other and can't see each other. And in a procedural environment, we then have to give lots of traffic, which ties up the frequency and we may need to separate you from IFR aircraft, which can be a major delay to IFR aircraft. So a good safari, work out who needs to come first and follow in trail. And if you are following, it's just like a Metro D tower. If you are following, don't overtake or don't do anything silly, because we don't know until you're arriving in the circuit who's who. We do have a local helicopter operator that does scenics via one of the points on the VFR route, Simpsons Gap, which is on VFR route 9 and 10. Be mindful if you are coming in via that VFR route that there may be helicopter traffic operating in the area. They do scenics, especially a couple of days of the week, that's based around the GAN arriving in Alice Springs, all the tourists that get off the GAN, so they're quite busy, but we don't treat them any different to any other fixed wing type of aircraft. Everybody just has to still look out the window and fit in.
Probably one of the most understated things here, apart from all of the rest of it, is you have to drink water. You have to drink all the time you're flying. You physically feel yourself drying out. There's a lot of birds, particularly over the McDonnell Range system. So it does pay to be mindful of that, particularly the wedge-tailed eagles. In their mind, they're king of the skies, so they don't like helicopters. And I can tell you there's no winners between a wedge-tailed eagle and a helicopter colliding.
We do get a lot of bird strikes. We have a big problem here at Alice with particular species of birds, black kites, brown kites, for example. They're large birds. They're an eagle-type size bird, and they tend to hover around the runways a lot looking for grasshoppers and insects. Usually we'll get a bit of a grasshopper plague or a mice plague, and then that'll bring the birds in, even worse, so being cautious of birds in the area. And wedge-tailed eagles, they certainly get up quite high, so not uncommon to get reports at a few thousand feet of birds in the area. Turbulence at Alice is traditionally associated with a late afternoon as the day builds up, but it's not uncommon at 7 o'clock in the morning for it to be plus 30 degrees as well, so the turbulence can exist all through the day, so it's something to be aware of. And the main thing is, if we've asked you to speed up to facilitate a sequence, if you're going to arrive before another aircraft and you do encounter that turbulence over the ranges, we are mindful of that fact. The main thing is with that is, if you need to slow down, that you tell us that you're slowing down, because if we've based your estimate on what you've told us from 50 miles and then you slow down for that turbulence or for any other reason, we need to know, because we've got no other information to sell us that you've done that. So that is a real key. With whatever instruction we give you, if you can't comply, you need to tell us about it and we'll work something else out. But leaving it to the last minute puts us in a bad situation.